Hi everybody, and welcome back to the continuing Doodle adventure. Today, we're on episode 2. Now, to recap what happened last time, we met our hero, Brian, the red-headed, sword-wielding adventurer who lives in a little village on top of a hill with his friend, Seamus the Robot. They enjoy having barbecues, despite the fact that barbecues are illegal on this hill because of the thatched roofs. One day, while having a barbecue, they were approached by Mayor Top Hat here, who asked them to go on an adventure. The adventure involved climbing to the snowy peak of this hill mountain to find a yeti who had been falling behind on his council tax payments. And while their adventure was, as the mayor put it, not to get that council tax back, but simply to make sure that the yeti was okay. Now, we're going to see part 2 of the adventure. Let's just get all of our felt tip pens. Out. All of the pencil case. What colours we have to be dealing with. We have brown pen, orange pen, blue pen, dark green pen, purple pen, light green pen, red pen, light blue pen, pink pen, yellow pen, sort of pinky purpley pen, slightly different, light purple, I suppose, and black pen. So, here comes Brian. Here, let's give him some sideburns. He is, of course, accompanied as ever by his best friend, Seamus the Robot. Nice blue tinge about. And Seamus and Brian leave their village. They go down to the bottom of the hill, and that's where they find a new shop. That they'd never seen before. It's a big window. It's got a bay window like that. So the window sort of sticks out a bit from the shop. This shop has a lovely red roof like that. Looks a bit like a fancy mushroom. And the shop has a sign on it, a green sign. No less a sign, more just some letters. It has a sort of wood panel like that. It's like that. And so Brian and Seamus see the shop, and Seamus asks Brian, "So it's a magic shop. Does that mean it's a shop that sells magic things? Or does that mean that the shop itself is magic?" And Brian ponders this for a little while before someone comes out of the shop. And it's quite a short wee guy that comes out. He's got wee arms. He's a wee happy wee guy. he's got a nice big ginger beard. Like that. And a pink hat. Not used pink yet, have we? So he's got a sort of pointy pink hat. And he says, "Hello, travellers. My name is Fibor, and I am the proprietor of yonder magic shop. Can I interest you in any magical items?" To which Seamus says, "Well, that's really answered my question there. The shop itself is but a standard shop, and it sells magical items." To which Fibor says, "Well, yes and no. The main purpose of the shop is of course to sell magical items, but the reason that I chose here to put the shop is because the building that was already occupying this space had itself a very magical trait, and that is that it's slightly bigger on the inside. Not by much. If I had to put a number on it, I'd say it's about 10% bigger than you would expect it to be looking at it from outside dimensions, which is actually fairly unnoticeable when it sort of comes to it. But I just thought, for a bit of sort of business synergy, I would establish my magic shop in a magic shop. And Seamus nods. He says, "You know, that's a very good idea. You've thought about that, and that's what. Let's go inside." So the three of them sort of go inside, and inside there's blue shelves, full of all manner of magical items. Now, because it's magical items, there's a great way to use some pencils. For example, you screen the vase. Can't really see that very well. just give it a green outline. Here we go. We have a got a light blue, got an orb. It's more of a, it's got a nice golden sheen to it. Yep. We have a purple. Game Boy. We have a purple pencil. Maybe we don't. What's this? That's a writing pen. Brian and Seamus come into the shop and they ask Feebor, you know, can you tell us what these things are for? He says, well, they're all, Feebor says, well, they're all very magical. They all have some sort of magical property. Feebor says, well, first of all, we have a Game Boy that never runs out of battery. And what's quite strange is that Game Boys actually take AA batteries. They don't have inbuilt batteries. They didn't until the Game Boy Advance SP. So that, well, you might ask, doesn't that mean that it's the batteries themselves that are infinite? The batteries are only infinite inside the Game Boy, and only this specific Game Boy. We don't know why, because other batteries inside the Game Boy work normally, and the batteries inside other things work normally. It's only the particular confluence of these two items that provides those results. And Brian says, that's good, but I can't really see how that's going to help us on our adventure. Seamus agrees. So Feebor moves on to the next item. He says, this lamp, Brian says, you know, let me guess, there's a wish-granting genie inside. And Feebor says, quite the opposite, actually. there is a genie in there, but the genie is he's not the wish granting kind. He's kind of, he's a bit annoyed about the sort of state of the things. He's sort of a rebellious genie, and he actually wants, if you're to make a wish, he just punch you in the face. That's it. That's all he does. He has the power to grant wishes, but the only wish, you know, you're not going to get your wish. All you're going to get is a punch in the face. Ironically, if you wish for a punch in the face, he'll kick you right in the small of the back when you least expect it. But we don't let him out, because there's no point. Ryan says, okay, well, we'll leave that. That seems pretty useless for our adventure. I come along here. The blue sphere. Ryan says, that seems pretty interesting. What's going on there? And Phoebor says, well, this blue sphere is it's actually just a paperweight. It's just a nice paperweight. If you have a lot of files, you know, you put that on top, keeps your paper together, stops it from flying off. And Seamus, despite being a robot, is actually fairly impressed by this. Because in this world, you know, paperweights hadn't been invented yet, so this was actually a sort of revolutionary design. Brian says, but what about this? What about this last one? This green vase. Phoebor says, well, whatever you plant inside that vase will grow huge. You put a dandelion in there, you're going to end up with the world's biggest dandelion. You put a cannabis plant in there, you're going to have a giant cannabis plant. You put a bean in there, and you're going to get your standard giant beanstalk. Brian says, that sounds good. Phoebor says, what, the cannabis part? Brian says, no, that does sound great, but mainly the sort of beanstalk sort of aspect, but I'll keep that for later. We might end up using that in our adventure. So Brian pays Phoebor, say, 65 gold. All the gold coins here. What about that? Just round. And they all have a picture on them of all the coins in the land. Oh, look at that. They all picture on them of a Ulchrat, the strong jawed. He was the first king of the magic kingdom that Brian and Seamus live in. He's called Ulchrat, the strong jawed, because as you can see, he had a very strong jaw. You know, could take a punch off of a genie like nobody's business. It took 18 genies to eventually kill him. They call them Jawsies. You know, there's 10 Jawsies is equivalent to about, I don't know, about $50. So it's quite a lot. There's also another type of coin. What colours are that going to be? There's a green coin. Because they actually have a green precious metal. And these are called called spikies. And those, and spikies, there's two spikies in every Jawsy. These ones represent the green crown that Ulchrat used to wear. So Feebor says, you know, for the vase that'll be 50. Well, that'll be 15 Jawsies and 3 spikies. That doesn't make any mathematical sense. That'll be 15 Jawsies and a spikey. So Brian hands him the money. Thank you. And away they go. Now they leave the shop and they turn the corner and they arrive base of the mountain. Ready to climb the mountain. But that's our story for next time.